everybody. Welcome to Bone to Pick. I am Michael Davis, and we are coming to you today from Euphoria Studios in Manhattan. And we are very, very fortunate, and indeed I would say it's my honor to have the opportunity to sit down with one of the preeminent bass trombone players anywhere in the world today. And for my money, I would have to call him the greatest orchestral bass trombone player in the history of the instrument, the great Charlie Vernon. In 1986, he followed Ed Kleinhammer, the legendary Ed Kleinhammer, and was appointed bass trombone of the Chicago Symphony Orchestra, a position he still holds. Previous to that, he was in the Philadelphia Orchestra for 5 years, the San Francisco Symphony for a year, and almost a decade with the Baltimore Symphony. He is an internationally acclaimed soloist on bass trombone, tenor trombone, and alto trombone. He's a world-renowned teacher and educator. He's currently the professor of trombone at DePaul University in Chicago. And I'm honored also that he was willing to play on a project I did many years ago called Brass Nation, and his playing was an absolute standout on the record. And he is also an avid swimmer and member of the Evanston Masters Swim Team. The great Charlie Vernon. Charlie, thank you so much for being with us today. I know you just finished a rehearsal. You ran down here, and you're running back to Carnegie Hall tonight. So thanks so much for taking
well,
the time.
Well, thank you. Thank you. I don't know how to respond to all that, those accolades. It's great to be here. And I remember that record fondly. You know, it was all these different brass ensembles and all of a sudden the Chicago Symphony. It was a different... You know, it was strange. Not that it was bad or anything like that, but it was just we're not accustomed to playing necessarily in a studio like that.
Right, so everybody... right. It was an amazing experience for me to work with you guys. Needless to say, but why don't we start? Thanks. You know, sure. A little bit at the beginning, and mm-hmm. you're growing up in Asheville, North mm-hmm. Carolina, mm-hmm. and also I was curious to, you know, what made you gravitate to the trombone in those early years?
Well, my earliest recollection to this is I came home in the seventh grade. We lived about, I don't know, 5-6 miles from school, and I walked home with a tenor drum, without the pad or the thing, the guard, mm-hmm. the drum guard, mm-hmm. walked there beating the drum the whole way. By the time I got home, my leg was just kind of bruised and bleeding and stuff. And my mother saw this, and she said, "Take that back, you know." God, what, you know? And I said, "Okay, you know." So I took it back. I don't know how I got it back the next day. It's funny how you remember certain things and don't remember most everything else. So I went back, and the band director said, "Well, let's see what we got." And I'll never forget this. He took me in the back of a room, and it was this brown case. Now, maybe it was at one time a black case or maybe a green case or something, okay. But it was brown. And I opened it up, and you remember those Olds trombones, little trombones, Olds with it had the green felt? I think the felt was still green. And there was this brown trombone in there.
Okay.
You know, it wasn't bright and
lost a little of its luster.
Yeah. And I remember my first reaction was, shit, I know what that is. I mean, I knew what the instrument was. And it's like I'd seen it in bands and wow. And I just this click of, whoa, I know what that is. And you know, then it was that's the way it started, and then I went back home and sat out on the front little porch hill, and just playing away. I've got lots of pictures of me when I was 12 years old, and one of them is in my book. Me going like this, and you know, all the way out and playing this thing. I don't know. I went from that, and then I got a King 3B. With an F attachment. That was my first real horn. It's a great horn. I don't know if they make it anymore or something like that, but it was a great horn. So mm-hmm. that's the way it started. And I'll have to say that every band rehearsal, every one of them that I ever remember, I was so excited all day long to get ready to go play. And while it was over, I just had so much fun playing. And then the section was over. Then the class was over, and then I had to go do other things, you know, whatever. I was on the swim team and stuff, you know. So, but I just remember that the excitement of how much fun it was to play and just, wow, you know. So it started like that. And you know, through high school, I played lead and all the and everything and the big bands and stuff. It was so much fun. And I knew immediately I didn't know where I was going to do it. I didn't know what I was going to do, whether I was going to play, be a band director or play in a jazz band or play in an orchestra. I didn't even know much about orchestras at that time. But I knew positively without any question in my mind that the trombone was going to be what I was going to be doing. Mm. It was not even a thought. You know, it was like, you know, you just saw it. Passionate about it, it didn't matter what anything else was. So that's the one great thing that I'm fortunate in my sons have passions like that as well, and it's fantastic, because if you don't have a passion, you go through life just trying to find yourself, and it's a real sad state. Anyhow, this passion.
That's great. You know, and, I mean, you know, and you still hate, the great thing is I hear you play today. It's like the same level of passion. I mean, you still bring it all the time. It's great.
Right. I mean, it's just tough. When you get old like this, you know, air is not, it sucks, you know. Air is not as good. You run out of air. You know, your lungs, instead of being real flexible and stuff, they're like this, you know, trying to get them to get more air in there. And that and the muscles, like the tonguing muscles, I'm the king of double tongue, you know, because I have to do it all the time on things that you would not even, people wouldn't even dream of doing it. Mm. And Gene has got even slower tongue than I do. So we're going da 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 da. I can't, you know, I wouldn't trust myself to go ta-ta-ta-ta unless I really, you know. So that's one of the things that really sucks about getting older is you had no air and your tongue doesn't move. That's one of the few things, but it has to do with it. It's a lot. But.
Well, I'll tell you what, you and Gene are still the best in the business. Well, so it's you may be getting older, but it's still
tonight,
working.
Is it tonight? Oh, my God, tonight is a huge Scriabin thing. This piece starts off with us going... and have to play that at least 15 times in the piece. Really, with the basses, cellos, contrabassoon, and us. And it's just, it's a constant. Some people call it a tapeworm. I like it better than that. But, you know, it's great.
That's,
it's great.
That's so awesome. I wish I could hear that. Well, no, not at all. That was great. Let's talk. You've had a lot of important mentors and teachers in your career and in life. I know you went to Georgia State, but maybe you could talk, you know, some of the standouts. Of course, the late, great Arnold Jacobs, I know, was a major impact on you. You could talk about that a little bit.
Okay. At Georgia State University, I studied with William Hill, who was a great teacher, and he would not let me play anything but Arbenz and Bordone. Mm. I wanted to play all these Pichiroux, all these really hard things. And see, I played the tenor trombone for a long time before I switched to the bass trombone. So in that period of time, he was great. Gail Wilson was my teacher in the summertime, who played in the Phoenix Symphony. He retired from Arizona State. And then I went to Chicago, and it just started all, you know, went in 1969. Harry Maddox, my old friend who played first trombone in the Atlanta Symphony, and I drove up in our Volkswagen Bug and had lessons for the first time with Arnold Jacobs. And that 6 months later came up again and had lessons with him and Ed Kleinhammer. Mm. And that just started, you know, that was the real impetus for really getting my act together. You know, Jake, you couldn't play anything in a lesson with him that he didn't catch and that how can I put this? You couldn't get away with anything. Every note that you played, he could tell if you were playing or if you were just playing. Mm. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
He could tell immediately if somebody's passionate and totally into what they're doing. And, you know, he would always say, what are you thinking? You know, well, you got to be thinking about the greatest sound in the world on the trombone while you're playing. You know, what would the greatest player in the world like sound like, you know? Mm-hmm. And he would mention, you know, all these people, you know. Tommy Dorsey was always a big fan. He always loved that name. And, you know, he said, when you're playing, while you're playing, you have to imagine that sound that you want in your head at the split second that you produce that sound and flood your brain with that sound. I was 21 years old when he was telling me this, and I was like, what is he talking about? Duh. Such a dummy, you know. I mean, it would go, I mean, I understood the words, but they didn't quite, I didn't get it. So it took me a year after that to where I finally figured out that, oh, wait a minute. You think about the sound that you want and you produce that sound and sing that sound while you're playing. Oh, see, I thought he meant, stupid, that you're sitting around thinking about, oh, what a great sound. I take a breath, boom, you know, like it's going to just appear. Didn't work that way. Anyhow, he was great. He was the nicest man and just a great musician and just was so inspiring to get me to think about playing great on every note that I played and taking a full breath, whether I needed it or not, and get the breathing apparatus of the playing and buzz the mouthpiece and all these basic fundamental things that I do to this day. And I'm on my students' butts mm-hmm. all the time about it.
You know, yeah.
They sit in front of me, and we play back and forth, you know, and buzz the mouthpiece and the whole thing. So Jake was incredible, and Ed was the most supportive and wonderful human being that I think I've ever really known. Mm. You know, I mean, that guy was just the salt of the earth. And he lived to be 93 years old. I think he was 93. And just great. And his work ethic was unmatched. You know, he one time in a lesson, you know, we had a lesson. We had many lessons, and we used to play duets a lot. I remember one time going in a lesson with him, and we had these cutaway mouthpieces that you put in the trombone, and it just has the rim buzzing, and you move the slide in to go along with it. And I went in one lesson. I said, Ed, do you mind if we just warm up playing? Because I was stiff. And he said, oh, no. So he pulls his out, and we sat there for 20 minutes playing a rim, you know, and moving the slide. And he was that kind of guy that then he would say, as he left, I have to go home now, but you can stay in the studio as long as you want, but why don't you work on B major for the next few hours? You know, like arpeggios, scales, just sound on those notes. And anyhow, he worked harder on the trombone than anybody I have ever known. And it was like, it was ridiculous. You know, if I practiced as diligently and worked at the time periods he worked, he'd get up at 5:30 in the morning and he'd practice, wow. You know. If I treated it like that, I'd be better than I am, for sure.
Probably true for all of us, you know. Yeah. That's a high level of dedication.
Yeah, very high. But he was great, sweetest sweetheart, just a wonderful. And he was the guy that set the standard for the bass trombone, orchestral bass trombone sound. Absolutely, there was nobody even close. And he and Jake, all we've done, Gene and I, are just trying to carry on a tradition, you know. And well, it's the tradition. It's definitely the thing. But it's hard, you know, and I look at those guys. See, when I was studying with them, they were not as not as old as I am now. That's ridiculous. You know, I remember I look at pictures of those guys in my book. I have two pictures of them, and I'm looking at them, and it's like, shit. He's about 40 or 45 there, and I remember him, or 50 maybe, and I'm thinking, oh, my God, what an old fart you are. And now I look at it. Sometimes I put there's a picture of it in there that where they're both standing there at Ravinia. Jake's got his tuba, and Ed's sitting there with a bass trombone, and they both have this kind of smirk on their face, you know, and I look at that while I'm playing a little Arbenz thing, and I'm thinking what he's thinking. Oh, come on, man, you suck. Play better than that. Oh, come on, what was that? You know. So I use the pictures and I remind of that to inspire me sometimes. But anyhow, those two guys are just my mentors, my teachers. Extraordinary.
Yeah, that's amazing. Well, thanks for sharing all that. Yeah. Well, the birth of one of the great orchestral brass careers began in 1971 when you joined the Baltimore Symphony. Can you talk about your time in Baltimore and what that was like, and maybe what the feelings you had getting that first win?
Okay.
First audition?
Let's see. How can I say this? What kind of editing power do you have? No. I'll just say it. You know, 21. I was 23 years old when I got that job, and you know, my first thought was, "Wow, I can own a set of tails." You know, I'm the bass trombone player in the Baltimore Symphony. Holy shit! You know, I was so excited because I'd been playing the Atlanta Symphony, just extra freelancing, and I would hear people. In the Atlanta Symphony, this is funny. Now, I mean, it's funny. It's just life. But you'd go to and be an extra guy playing, and let's say a bass clarinet player or something was sitting around complaining about this, that, and the other. And I looked at him once and said, "What are you doing? Why are you complaining about anything? You've got this great job." I just unloaded on him, you know. But no, so I was deliriously happy playing down there. But when I got the job, it was, you know, it's so funny. And the personnel manager, you know, go in. I'm a kid, and he said, "Well, we're prepared to offer you." I said, "What was it? $25 over scale." It doesn't matter. I didn't say I'll play for free, but it was like, oh, it doesn't matter. You know, that's great. You know, stupid. You know, those things when you're young, you don't know anything. But no, it was great. You know, the section around Dave Fetter was there. He was really, really experienced and a really nice guy, great guy. And then, you know, the second was really, we're all nice people, you know, and just, but I was this kid. That was just fresh out of college and just hell bent on playing the way that I had been taught to play, and over a period of 2 or 3 years, section changed a little bit. Jim Olin got in there on second trombone, and Dan Brown became the tuba player. It was really pretty damn good for a long time, and. You know, we just played a lot of things, and I kind of grew up there. Mm-hmm. All my, you know, I was married. I was kind of married there when I went there, and that didn't make it. And then I got married again while I was there, and that didn't make it. So I got married again right after I left, and then that's my third and last wife, and the fact that she puts up with me at all is pretty amazing. We've been together for 33 years. So.
Oh, that's great.
But those days were fantastic, you know, just playing for the first time so many pieces of music that, you know, that you've heard all your life. And it was great. You know, I'm surprised I have any brain cells left after those years. But I tell you, it was so much fun. I had so much fun. But, you know, this is something that's important in that all those years that I was there, practicing especially in the mid 70s when I developed like 73, 74, 75, 76 in there, I started people in the United States or whatever, the ITA was was becoming a kind of a important thing, and mm-hmm. and me and John Marcellus and John Melick actually started the a couple other guys started the ETW back in Towson. Anyhow, so that hooked on, and I developed. I was really playing really well, and playing a lot of solos, and really becoming my own player. And so I would go to these conventions, and it was a really big deal for everybody, and it was a big deal for me too. I had a great time playing, and in the Baltimore Symphony, we were playing great concerts. It was a great orchestra. It is a great orchestra. But all that time during those years in the Baltimore Symphony, all I could think about, Philadelphia Orchestra or Chicago Symphony or something over there, mm-hmm. instead of being in the present moment mm-hmm. where you are.
Yeah.
You know, when you're young, you don't know that. And even when you're old, you don't know that. You know, it's
It's a great piece of advice. I mean, try to live in the moment, because that's all we really have. You know, I mean, it's likely that we're going to have more, but you know,
we can only hope.
It's only in the moment.
But. You're right. That's an incredible thing. So, that I wish there was some way in my life that at that time when I was healthier and younger and had better lungs and all kinds of things that I could have done, and I wish I'd have done a lot of things. You know, of course. I want a do-over. Is that possible to get a do-over? I want to start over again and go back with what I know now, and man, look out. I'd be a 10th degree Don in Taekwondo by then. I all kinds of shit would have happened.
Well, I'm not sure if you did it over, you'd be any better at the bass trombone, I'll tell you.
I don't know.
About as good as it gets.
No.
I think the first time I got to meet you, and I was a student at Eastman and a student of Doc's, and he brought you in, and I know we started following your career pretty intently at that point.
Yeah.
The late, great Steve Witzer and I were
played
in a quartet together, and we would always say, what's Charlie up to? And then you won the job in San Francisco. And I remember us all hearing that you got Philly 1 year later. We were like, oh, he's only going to be in San Francisco for a year. So it was, maybe you could talk a little bit about that year in San Francisco. And then of course, your time in Philly mm-hmm. was so perhaps one of the, I mean, if not the best, it's certainly in the top few trombone sections of all time with the late, great Glenn Dotson. Glenn. And, of course, Joe Alessi, probably the preeminent orchestral trombone mm-hmm. player anywhere, mm-hmm. anytime. But anyway, if you could talk about that as well as the time in San Francisco.
Yeah, that was a hell of a time of my life, in that I left the Baltimore Symphony, and it was like, wow, I got this job, and it's in San Francisco, California, holy cow. And, you know, so that was just a new thing. You're going out there in a new hall, new conductor, a great orchestra, maybe better than what I was playing in. But different, you know, just different. Not so much better, but just different. And but the situation, whenever you're in another orchestra like that, that there's more money, and all the things that go along with that, you know, it, you know, people play a little bit better. I don't know how to describe it. It's just a little bit more world class kind of thing. Anyhow, I had a great time. Lived in Berkeley.
Mm-hmm.
It was just it was a wonderful time, and had made great friends. My oldest friend is Glenn Fishdahl, trumpet player. Mm-hmm. We played golf, and oh my gosh, I'm surprised I can see still. But he and I were always together, and he's just was the most laid back and cool guy. And it was him, me, Mark Lawrence, and Floyd Cooley. We're a real tight knit team there, and we were all within 6 months of each other the same age, mm-hmm. and that has something to do with it. I think I was 32 or so, I forget the age, but we were all the same age, and all were going after the same thing and everything, and it was great. I had a great time, and Ado DeVart was damn good, and he still is. I like him a lot, and so we had a good section, really good section, really good brass section. It was more controlled. Everybody was trying to make sure that it was exactly right and everything, and that's okay. I came from another place in that, you know, it was, you know, you know, I don't know how to describe it, but it's funny. And then I got the audition February 3rd. I remember Mason Jones, horn player and personnel manager, sent me a little card. What is it, 4x6 card, just a flat piece of paper with my name and address on the other side. It says February 3rd, 10 o'clock. That's all it was. And so, okay. I had written, of course, before then, so I was invited to the Philadelphia Orchestra bass trombone audition. And I made the finals. I think it's hard to remember. That's what I mean, short term, whatever the memory of that. But I made the finals, and next thing I knew, I was walking down the stage, and Muti was right out there in front of us, and Cat Rabick, and all these guys. And I played, and, you know, Bach Cello Suite has been one of the, you know, all the Bach Cello Suites, but the Sarabande has always been a big solo for trombone players to play. And I remember in the San Francisco Symphony, I got the job, and I played it as it's written. And on Philadelphia Orchestra, I played in tenor clef down an octave, which to me, starting on a D, B flat, G flat, you know, to me it's just so easy. I can't even describe the feel of just playing. Mm-hmm. The other one, it's easy, but you know, you're going in that middle upper register, you know, mid register is probably the hardest register on trombones, but anyhow, that's another story. played this thing, and it was like, I thought, okay, I've got to find something to play that's going to make me feel really comfortable and just get me warmed up, and it was perfect. Mm. You know, it was perfect for that. And, you know, after a while, I remember Cat Rabick saying to me, why are you leaving San Francisco? You know, which is a normal thing, and I look back in my life, I'm thinking, well, why did I do that? But I looked at him, and I said, this is the Philadelphia Orchestra, you know? And, you know, so that made a little impression, a good impression, I think. But I got that job, and then, because I knew Glenn was there, and I had been listening to recordings of course, he's always been a favorite of mine, and I always were at these trombone conventions. We were together and stuff like that. But then I got that job, and then I heard about this kid in Curtis who got a job playing second trombone there, you know. And so we got there and played in Muti. So it was Ricardo Muti. Holy shit. Glenn Dodson. Wow. And this kid on second trombone. And a really good tuba player, but the trombones, it was amazing. And let's see, Dick Woodhams, principal oboe. I would just listen around, and I would hear all these things. And this was, Ormandy was the first person I ever played with, actually. He started off. But I was blown away by the difference of the way that we played in San Francisco is the way they played in Philadelphia. Philadelphia was rank abandon. What was it? Kleinhammer's thing was, a rank abandon. No, I forget the name of it. It's abandoned, but controlled abandon. What is that called?
I don't know what that is.
Controlled abandon. Anyhow, it was like with control of the sound and stuff like that. But that was, you know, and Joe, all right, okay. See, he was 18 or 19 years old. And Glenn and I used to hammer him all the time, give him shit right and left, you know, especially Glenn. You know, and he called himself, I forget how the terminology, but he's the sponge. You just accept shit between the two of us. Older guy and an older guy and then this kid in the middle, you know. So, but it was great. We had a lot of fun. We sang in a barbershop quartet and we played in a barbershop quartet. So Roger Blackburn played trumpet and soprano trombone some. Glenn and Roger sang the lead. Glenn played the lead part and sang the bass. Joe played and sang the baritone part, and I played the bottom part and sang the very top part. And you know, it was pretty atrocious. My wife used to just couldn't believe how we'd gar, you know, the art. Singers, you know, they don't do that kind of stuff. But none of us were singers. Roger did a good job, though. But we had a great time.
I was fortunate to have Joe as a bone to pick guest for 1 month, and he had equally fond memories of the barbershop quartet.
We had a great time. It was, you know, it was a great time. And, you know, I've got their videos of it, and there's tapes of it and stuff that were just a lot of fun. So, but playing in that section and playing in that orchestra with Muti, he would just, he'd look back there and just, you know, this excitement of what he wanted, and rank abandon. I said that already. Shit. controlled abandon.
Controlled abandon. Okay,
controlled abandon. And that's what Kleinhammer always used to talk about. And that's the way we played in Philadelphia Orchestra. You know, it was like, you know, and then Chicago was different. It's a different kind of controlled abandon, but at any rate. But Philadelphia, that was 5 years of still growing, you know, still young, kind of a young kid, kind of. I was 30-something, 33, something like that. But that was a great time in my life, and became really close friends with a lot of those people. And then I just had to, you know, when Kleinhammer retired, it was just, I had to do it. I had to try.
Yeah.
You know? And I was not, you know, there was no special treatment. I had to go through preliminaries and all the same thing. The only good thing about that was that the preliminary was on the day before or something like that of the finals. So they, you know, when somebody has a big job, they kind of let you, but you still have to play behind the screen and go through the stuff. And I got in and then got the job. Holy cow. But Muti didn't like that. And we have.
Well, we were talking before the interview about your relationship with Muti, and it's a perfect segue into now. But let's talk about Chicago, your time there. Obviously, following Ed Kleinhammer must have been an unbelievable thrill for you, and also, of course, I mean, all due respect to all the great brass sections and all the orchestras of the world, but certainly Chicago has to be considered, if not the greatest, in the handful of the greatest brass sections ever. But it must have been a thrill to be playing with Bud Herseth and all the great players that to play with there. But anyway, talk to us about Chicago Symphony and also about your relationship.
Let me get into that a little bit. So when I got the job, and it was so funny, we were doing in Philadelphia. All this stuff, and I was playing the fourth trombone part, which it should be on a trombone of some sort instead of this stupid cimbasa. Okay, but that's another story. Okay, he and I are having a little tussle with that right now. But but I remember doing this on just the bass trombone, and rehearsal was over, and he looked back at me. I know. I think he said, I know. And then he walked off, you know. And he knew that I was going to Chicago the next day to audition. And we had talked about it. And I had told him, I said, you know, Maestro, it has nothing to do with you. This is just something I have to do. I have to try. You know, probably not going to get it, but I have to try, you know. And then I went and I got it. Holy cow. What a miracle that is. It's predestined. I'm convinced of that it's all, it's a force of destiny, kind of like it is with he being in the Chicago Symphony's music director. But anyhow, so I got it. And then we went through Chicago Symphony, Philadelphia Orchestra, Chicago Symphony, you know, negotiating, you know. Philadelphia Orchestra, Chicago Symphony wouldn't budge at a certain point. But I knew that there was a certain point where I knew, and all those meetings we had, I must have had a dozen things with Muti, trying to talk me out of doing it, you know. And it was always, but it's hard to explain. But we became where I could talk to him as a human being. And we became acquaintances, friends over those 4 or 5 years. And where he liked me a lot and I loved him. And it was just a really good relationship. And when I left, he was probably hurt a little bit, but he did understand, I hope. He won't admit it. He will not to this day admit that. I said, Maestro, if I'd have stayed there, I would still be there. I'm not sure if you would be here. It's just a force of destiny. Yeah. I have some things I can say about that. And he just sits and, you know. But I think he's the last time we talked about it, you know, he said, I know, or something like that. So it's okay. But so I made the break, did an awful move going from Collingswood, New Jersey, living on the high speed line, cost of living, nothing, hardly, easy life, never having to drive, wonderful, great orchestra, just easy life, to exactly the opposite of that. You know, having to drive all the time, you know, I had to, you know, to get a house was really expensive. You know, it's like living here. Maybe it's not as bad as this is. I'm sure it's not as bad as this is. But going from a place like that to Chicago with the life part of it was really difficult. Went there with my wife was pregnant with our first son, and you know, she didn't want to leave to begin with. So, mm-hmm. you know, I had many years of accepting shit for the mistake that I made of leaving. Right. So all that went on and on and on, and Muti, you know, we stayed in touch over the years, and you know, I would write him every now and then, and I'd see him every now and then. It was great, you know. Charlie, you know, it was just great every time. And finally, when Barenboim was leaving, you know, I thought, of course, I have to say this, especially if this is going to be where anybody can actually see this, but my wife came up with all the ideas.
That's the right answer, Charlie. I like that.
She did. She is the idea person. I swear she should be queen of something because she has the ideas and she makes them, puts them into action, and then instructs people to do these things. And I just did everything she said, you know, as far as, you know, you need to write him, you need to stay in touch with him, you know, especially about this upcoming thing. And at any rate, it boiled down to the committee, which I was not on, the search committee. I was mm-hmm. not on that. And all these people had this list of all these conductors. You know, I mean, 3 or 4 pages of list. And I went to the president and I said, you've got to be kidding me. There's one person on here. You should throw away everything else. There's only one person here that should be playing, should be leading this orchestra. And they all listened to me a little bit. Oh, yeah, yeah, and we'll try, you know. And so I thought to myself, forget this. I'm going in the back door. And so I proceeded to really try to court him and, you know, just these little things. And then after a while, he finally came and conducted us. And the orchestra fell in love with him, you know. And I was thinking, well, you know, they should, you know. That was not a surprise to me. And everybody was going, wow, he's great. And I said, no shit, he's great. You know. Anyhow, so that boiled into, I had people, I told people to write letters give them to me, write letters, we'll send them letters after the tour about what you thought about, you know, because they're always saying, God, he was great. And I said, yes, he was great. Write it in writing. Mm-hmm. So I collected all these letters from 80 or 90 people, and I had a big poster made up of, said, La Forza del Destino, picture of him, Chicago Symphony, you know what I mean, a big thing, and all kinds of other cards and things that, I would send with having the orchestra sign the card to get well card and putting a little space up at the top that I said, well, there's going to be a get well card there. And so nobody signed it. So I had a picture. Somebody took a picture of the empty podium. And see, if I'd have put this up there, they wouldn't have signed it.
Right. You know? Right.
Empty podium. And I wrote, waiting for you. And everybody signed it.
Wow, what a great
story. Knew that. Nobody knew that. And they all these union guys would, oh, we can't do that. Blah, blah, blah. You know, so I didn't care what anybody thought because this was important. This went over, this was the most important thing, is to get this person on the stage and give him a chance for him to decide if he wanted to do this. Mm-hmm. So those letters, all the extra stuff, turned him to the Chicago Symphony, and they negotiated for, I don't know, 6 months or 5 months or something, all these, the lawyers on each side, and my wife, I text him a lot, you know, and he's actually can text back. It's amazing. He does it every now and then. He's got one of the phones like you have, you know, AABB. And so, there was a point there where I was, you know, just texting him, and sometimes we'd call. After about 4 or 5 texts, he would call me, which was great. And, you know, just talk about different things because I always wanted him to know what was going on here, what he should be aware of,
right.
Just general helping him in that way, not a negative thing, but just because I wanted him here. I didn't care what it took to get that to happen. Then all of a sudden there was silence, and I kept saying, Allison, you know, I just want to text him. No, don't text him. There's something going on. And she convinced me not to communicate for a few months with him. And the next thing I knew, I get a call from the president of the orchestra that said, Charlie, you might want to come down on Monday afternoon. And my first thought was, Monday, that's our day off. I don't want to go down. And then right after that, they sent a message to the entire orchestra, email or something, for everybody to come down on Monday. And Allison said, there's something up. So I'll never forget walking downstairs. John, the personnel manager, John Deverman, he saw me walking by, and he turned his computer screen around and said, Ricardo Muti is named new music director of Chicago Symphony. And I just sat down and cried like a baby.
Wow.
Right at that moment in time. Because it was like, oh, thank you, God. Because it was the epitome of, you know, of a lot of work and all that kind of stuff, but just like, oh, finally, you know, these people don't really know yet how great he really is, and you know, he's coming back. You know, so it was the greatest thing musically that I've ever experienced. You know, and then I talked to him after that. It was.
What a great story. You're absolutely right. Talking about destiny. That was
yeah.
Well, and the force of your will. You like
it was
single-handedly.
You had to. But somebody had to do something.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
You know?
Well, you know, it impressed me when you walked in today. It was great to see you after so many years. But, you know, I have lots and lots of buddies who play in orchestras. You know, most of the time they're not totally thrilled with the conductor, I would have to. Maybe most is a little exaggerated, but more than half the time.
Yeah.
And you came in and we're talking about tonight's concert at Carnegie Hall and just glowing about Muti and how an incredible time this is for the mm-hmm. orchestra. And so what an amazing,
it's phenomenal.
Great story.
It's phenomenal.
Charlie, I just want to shift gears a little bit. Mm. One of the things that's always impressed me about you, in addition to your incredible virtuosity and your orchestral playing, is your solo career. And you've always been very open to all kinds of music, which I think the passion you have for music extends well beyond mm-hmm. orchestral music. And in fact, when Kent and I were touring with the Stones, Charlie and Gene Picorni, the incredible tuba player of the Chicago Symphony, came to the concert. And I remember how excited you guys were. And I talked to you the next day, and you said, "If you ever sub out, I want that gig." You know, But and of course, that's one of those types of gigs you don't sub out.
No,
but
no.
But that said, it struck me as very consistent with what I thought of you already, is that you're just open to music, and your solo career has kind of illustrated that in a musical kind of way. But I'd love for you to talk about, you know, you've commissioned a lot of works, you've worked with, you know, everybody from Christian Lindbergh to you know, just a whole range of folks. But talk a little bit about how you have approached your career as a soloist.
Okay, when I was in the Baltimore Symphony, of course, I played. I remember one year, I think I played about 30 recitals in one year once. You know, that's a lot.
Yeah.
And now I'm lucky to, you know, do a recital every 2 years or something like that. Not really. But no, but I was always, I always wanted to put the bass trombone, especially out there in that solo way, because, you know, I had something I had to say, and I wanted to do it with that kind of sound and way of playing. And I have to say, going back just a little bit backward, when I got in the Chicago Symphony and I sat on the stage and I sat there, and there's Arnold Jacobs sitting right there, my teacher.
Mm-hmm.
Holy cow. Frank Crisafulli is right there. Jay, right there. Herseth, right there. You know, it's like Clevenger right in front of my face. It was unbelievable. It was like Philadelphia Orchestra was incredibly great, and then all of a sudden I was sitting there in this world-class place that we all dreamed about from the earliest ages of what it would be like to play in the Chicago Symphony. And I have to say, it was the easiest thing I've ever done. You sit there and you just play.
Wow.
And you fit in. I mean, it's like, it's different than any place else, you know. And, you know, I've played in all these other orchestras, and I've played in the Boston Symphony just subbing. Doug was sick once. And I played, and it seems to me I played a couple other places too. I played a few places, but Chicago is the easiest one to play in. So at any rate, I wanted to bring that down. I just want to make sure, because Jake, to play with him was incredible. I would sit there and watch him take these huge breaths. I mean, he didn't have much air, so he would just suck air from his lips. His body would go boom, 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 boom. And he got the best sound on the tuba that I'd ever heard, you know, and it was just phenomenal. And there he was. Oh, my God. So it made me really, you know, even try to play better. Although in lessons with him, I never felt like that. I played for shit, you know. It's like, you know, because I was always wondering what he was thinking, which was stupid. But rarely did I feel comfortable playing for him. It was always, he was always the teacher, but really always my friend as well. Because I carried his tuba up and down the stairs. I had music blown up for him and all kinds of stuff like that. I remember a lesson with him once was, a lot of lessons I had with him were on the tenor and alto trombone. I was just working on that aspect of my playing. And I remember playing Sentimental Over You once in a lesson. And there were two things. One of them was with Kleinhammer. That's the quote I'm going to tell you. And the other one was with Ed, with Jake. Some of these, like B to F sharp, slurs weren't as good, and I would screw them up every time. There was always something right there towards the end where B to F sharp, something could have been smoother. And he looked at me and said, "You play the opening of that incredibly beautifully. Why can't you play those little things? Why can't you keep the concentration up?" You
know? Right, right.
So every time I play it now, which I played that a lot in front of, I've played it for funerals, I've played it for all kinds of different things. Mm-hmm. I played it on encores after Chickabone. I played it a bunch of times. And every time I get to that part, I think about what he said. And Ed was so nice. Once I played it for him, and he said, Tommy wishes he could have done it that good or something like that.
Awesome.
I'm going, holy shit. it was just his opinion at the time. Anyhow, so as far as the solo stuff goes, I would always play recitals, and I'd always go to these big conventions. And it's funny now, you know, the older you get, the political part of these conventions changes. There was a part there where it was, new stars, and then there was a part where it was college teachers, and then it's changed around a lot, you know, and it's how much ass you kiss,
Yeah.
I mean, they're nice guys, and I love them, but it was a fantastic place to go and play the bass trombone, especially that in front of all these people and that have never heard that kind of sound necessarily. Mm-hmm. So that was, and I always, you know, I had played a bunch of standard solos on the tenor trombone and stuff with bands and a couple with orchestras earlier on. But the bass trombone just didn't have the music, you know, it's been maddening. So I'd play pieces. I remember John Swallow walking off stage. I walked off stage after playing the Spillman Bass Trombone Concerto, which is not a great piece, but it's great for your playing mm-hmm. for a bass trombone because it doesn't go any above a F above the staff and goes down to pedal C, you know, if you do the things you want to do. And all this stuff, it's really exceptionally fine for playing. Kind of like Eric Uwazin's music is wonderful for your chops. It's because when he sings in that baritone voice range, you know, when he composes, mm-hmm. and so much of it goes into the that lower partial, the one below, and right in the middle register that most tenor trombone players have difficulty with, which this is why I'm on their case all the time. Okay, but these pieces, there were not very many. So John, as I walked off, said, when are you going to find something that's really a great piece of music? You know, why waste your time with this? And I said, well, John, it's like, give me something else.
Yeah,
And so there hasn't been. Ellen Swillick wrote me a concerto. Frank Siekman wrote me a concerto. And Christian Lindbergh wrote this incredible piece that I play. I've played it 24 times now.
Is that right? Wow.
Yeah, yeah.
That's incredible.
It's awesome.
Yeah, no, I know.
I plan to play the keep on playing it. I've got a wind ensemble arrangement of it, and I've got a brass band arrangement. I'd love to play that. I played it once in the brass band. It's Chickabone Checkout. It's by Christian Lindbergh for alto, tenor, and bass trombone, and switching back and forth. And so that. What he did for me on this piece is gives me an opportunity to do so much of the things that I can do but never get a chance to do. Mm-hmm. You know? I mean, like to play Schumann, play Rhenish. I've played it once in my life on the alto trombone. It's fantastic. It's easier than playing the bass trombone part, but that's another story. I mean, it doesn't take any air. Anyhow, so, no, but... But Christian wrote these things. It was so funny the way he wrote it. He said, I told him, I said, wow, would you consider writing me a bass trombone concerto, you know? It's just, you know, we need something on the bass trombone. There's not anything great that I've found that I can play yet. You know, there's a Schneider, there are some good pieces, but I haven't experienced them yet. There mm-hmm. are some, but I don't think there's anything great yet. But anyhow, I said, you know, maybe, and I showed him all the things I'd like, you know, at least things to put in there if you could, and things to avoid, you know. So we spent a lot of time later on, you know, videotaping me playing all the instruments. But while we were in that first conversation, and, you know, while you're at it, maybe throw in something on the alto trombone, really high and soft and some beautiful thing. And you know, maybe on the tenor, a ballad or something, and some really low notes, loud notes on the tenor trombone that is going to kind of limit who can play it.
Yeah. Also, I was just going to say, we've narrowed it down to one person who can play this now.
That's another story. But so at any rate, we, and next thing I knew, over since 2003, 2006, in those 3 years, he would send me little bits and pieces and, you know, have me choose this and that and other. And finally, the thing that was phenomenal, and this is one of the coolest things, is the way he wrote it. He would say, "What's your favorite note to play loud on the bass trombone?" And we're filming and stuff. And I said, "Well, low C, you know." And, you know, and I said, "I can play it for two beats really loud." Or let's say pedal F or pedal D. Got one beat, Christian. You don't write it for a whole note with three Fs under it. It's just not going to happen. So when you write these things, that's it. That's all you got. So he wrote everything custom for me as far as the notes that took a lot of air and the loud things. And the soft things, I told him what registers sounds great in the bass trombone and just, you know, that middle, low register. And then he said, "What's your favorite note what's your favorite notes on the tenor trombone? What place do you call?" He said it, he called it the cantilena. I'm not sure, just a singing register. And I said, you know, maybe up to C sharp or E flat or something like that, just in that octave, soft and smooth, that's fine. You can go higher than that if you want. But, and then the alto trombone, I said, you can put most anything you want in there. I mean, you know, he was talking about loud playing. I said, "Well, you know, I can play those notes, but maybe don't go any higher than high F sharp. You know, I can play high G maybe if I have to," and I've done it. But I said, "You know, keep it." And he put several F sharps in there, and some really high notes on the alto, some really incredibly fun things to play on the tenor trombone, ballads, and the bass trombone is like, the vehicle is the impetus, it's this meat of the whole piece. You know, there are people that can play all three instruments.
Right.
And, you know, there's some that can actually maybe even play, go through the piece and possibly play one after another like that. It's the level of how they play the bass trombone is the real key thing, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, a lot of trombone players can play the tenor trombone stuff nowadays, even with pedal F really loud and stuff like that, low D's and stuff. But and the alto trombone, there are a lot of people that can probably play that. But to play the bass trombone the way it should be played and to put them all together, that's another thing. Now, the reason that works so well for me, and it might not work well for other people, in that he wrote these. He never took me, in other words, start off with this screaming alto trombone stuff. Stop, stop. Next note I play, pick up the bass trombone, play a pedal C. Two or three of those, some low notes, just a nice little melody thing, low. Put it down, pick up the tenor trombone, ba-da-dee-da. Not the F, not C, but starting on a C. So it started like up in here in this register, then it went way here, then the piece started right there. It didn't start in the register like that middle register on the tenor trombone. It started up higher. So it enabled me. I have a, you know, on the alto trombone and the tenor trombone up high, I put more top lip in the mouthpiece, and it's always been kind of a natural thing to do. When I play in the tenor trombone in the middle register, it takes more work for me to do that it's closer, like the bass is so big that that just lays right in there. And the alto, I can play it to a certain point down there, and if I have to change around, I can do it, and it's easier. The tenor trombone sucks. I'll just have to say that right out. When I prepare, and I've played this 25 times, 24 times, I practice the tenor trombone more than any of the other instruments to get ready for this, and there's much more to play on the bass and the alto than the tenor. The tenor's got one, like two movements that kind of coincide, but they are in and out of this kind of middle register. And to start off in a place that's high on it, it was fantastic. And then it's all this ballad stuff. And then you got to go boom, dugga, 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 all this kind of middle low stuff. It takes me more time. It's because the mouthpiece is just smaller. And I have to work. I have to practice it more, which I didn't intend for this to happen.
Christian's not part of the deal.
He screwed that up. But then you play that for a while, and then all of a sudden, bum, 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 bass trombone's like, oh, God, that feels so good. And then play that for a long time. And this is the interesting thing. You're playing all this crazy shit, all this low stuff, fast, low. All of a sudden, there's this really, it's called Morning with Orange Juice. And this beautiful muted brass chord and strings come in all of a sudden on this F. Let's see. What note do I come in on? Come in on high A. Up to a D. And it's like it's the third. What's the third of the chord? If that's an A, it's an F7 chord, okay? So it's a beautiful chord coming on. And pick up the alto trombone, put it right in that spot, and play that A. It's the easiest thing I've ever done in my life. It doesn't make any sense. It's because of all that other stuff here, and then all of a sudden, fresh meat. Okay, so I play this, and then in the middle of that, it gets hard because it's high, and it gets loud and stuff. But it's okay. Then put it down, play bass trombone again. Turn the page. Trombones are walking behind me. They're playing all this stuff. We do a trio, and I turn the page, pick up the alto trombone, and play by the line. And then I'm thinking, "Holy shit! Now it's beginning. I'm beginning to get tired." That's 20 minutes into it, but it was masterfully crafted for my mouth by Christian Lindbergh.
Wow,
it's unbelievable. Ellen Swillick didn't. It wasn't masterful. It was hard, and it was just. All the thing it takes much more practice and energy for me to play that piece than it does for the Christian's piece, which people would never believe that in their wildest dreams.
Yeah, well, with all that insight, I see exactly what you're saying.
you know?
I do have to add that I can't remember which ITA I heard you at, but when you did a recital and you played bass trombone, alto, and tenor on consecutive pieces.
Yes, that was.
And it still blows my mind. I mean, it's just and. If I heard one of those pieces individually, I would say, "Well, the guy's an alto trombone player," you know. Yeah. But meanwhile, it's Charlie Vernon. So we should all look out for that piece because that sounds like something really special.
It's great for the
trombone repertoire.
Yeah, and I've been fortunate enough to play it enough to where I played with the Navy Band the last few times, and played the Monterey Symphony. I've played in just different places and. And it blows everybody away. And I wear this zoot suit.
Yeah, I've seen the.
Oh, man, it's great. And so I rented that. And then when I showed them a picture of the New York Times of me in it to the people who I rented it, they said, okay, it's yours.
Yeah.
So I've had it altered a little bit. And it's fantastic. My wife won't let me wear anything else. I thought about getting a black one, but it's perfect, you know. So, but that's, you know, that's an unusual. I just wish that somebody would maybe be interested in writing something else like that for me to play in that combination. Mm. Are you familiar with Bruce Appermont?
I'm not.
He wrote this concerto called Colors.
Okay.
And the Dimage Concerto, it's called Rare, Medium, and Well Done. Or something. It's a big tenor trombone concerto. some composer like that could possibly write something that would be incredibly wonderful to listen to and a great piece, but I'm not sure if anybody could write it with the same concern for who they're writing for, yeah, like Christian did.
Yeah,
he's unbelievable. That guy is ridiculous.
Yeah, no,
great composer, great conductor, and a great player. It's ridiculous.
It's an amazing.
It is ridiculous how he is.
I hate him. Charlie, as we kind of wind down today, I wanted to combine these two topics into one. I think, you know, you've kind of talked about the importance in from your mentors, Jake and Kleinhammer, and I'm sure that's become a big part of your style as a teacher. You're in addition to all the things you've done as a player, you're also world renowned as a teacher. Maybe you could share your approach to teaching, and then the second part of it would be, what do you offer to young people today that are out there saying, I want to be the next Charlie Vernon, and you know, especially with the competition level now is just so intense trying to get in any orchestra, let alone the Chicago Symphony.
Man.
But what kind of combine those two thoughts, if you can, as far as education and your students, and then. You know, how do you guide them to that, hopefully getting to that end result?
Yeah, well, as far as teaching goes, how can I put it? The most important thing, as far as I'm concerned, in teaching and playing is, first of all, getting a great sound and getting one sound that goes to another sound without any crap in between the sounds. That's huge. It's called lip slur. And it's I love your stuff that you've written out like that, because that's all that is, and it's fantastic.
Thank you.
It really is great. And
Thanks, Charlie.
Certain people have put stuff out there. Brad Edwards, for instance, fantastic books about slurring. It's not so much, and he, of course, he talks about it too, and you talk about it on yours as well, but the physical part of just doing all these lip slurs and all these different keys and stuff and playing melodies where you don't tongue anything except the first note after a breath is phenomenal. And that's the way that I've always taught, and that's the way that I always play myself. I'll never forget a lesson with John Swallow coming in on the bass trombone, and I'm playing a Vivaldi bassoon concerto or something like this, you know, like an adagio or something. He said, okay, it sounds pretty good. Now, you can't play anything in first or second position. Okay. And so, from that moment on was a learning thing that I always do now. Whenever, and he always would say, if it's a half step, I usually tongue it. Mm-hmm. But if it's a whole step, I'm going to slur it somewhere. Mm. And he said, you know, like a B flat and fifth is like a different note, on a string, it'd be this one instead of an open note. And he said, sure, it's a little bit different quality of sound. And there is a little bit of difference, but in certain ways, certain places, out front, nobody can tell the difference in a recital or something like that. But the main reason he wanted you to do it was to have your lips singing from note to note with no tongue in there. So it would be this constant buzz with your lips. And so my huge thing nowadays, and it's always been this way, but I've finally been able to, I'd go to these master classes, these big clinics, or these conventions, and in my 20s, just foaming at the mouth about this and that and the other, and I'd be over here, and I'd remember. So I've really done pretty good at pulling it together. And I've come up with this idea, and get a great sound on the trombone. In your mind, and at the moment that you play, you sing that sound. That's the first thing. The other thing is that you can't get a sound on the trombone that's any good unless you take a full breath, unless there's Unless there's a flow of air underneath it. So you got this sound going in your head, and you got this air that's underneath the sound. And then the next thing is the rhythm, because the rhythm shows you when to do stuff. Mm-hmm. It shows you when to move your lips in a lip slurp. Okay, you know this, but you know, it shows you when to move your lips, because you're always in a lip slur, you're buzzing the note, and you buzz right down to the pitch, and it goes right in time. The tongue, when you do have to tongue, goes in time with the buzz. So you got two things going, buzz and lip tongue when you're tonguing. And the one that's the most pain in the ass that people screw up the most is the slide. Mm-hmm. The slide's got to go in time. It doesn't go like that, and it doesn't go like this. It goes boom, 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 boom. So all those three things, and this is the fourth one. I did something stupid yesterday with that. Anyhow, thumb, or these. That's, let's say this is number four, or the valves on a trombone, whatever. They have to go exactly with the rhythm. So the rhythm shows you where to play, what to do. The air supports the sound that you're playing, and the tone quality and the tone quality and the driver of the truck, the musician that's leading all this, is in charge, and that's the artistic part of it. Mm. So in my teaching, you know, there are those four, and I'm mainly those three things. And, you know, when you have students and they, you know, they can't do a normal lip slur, just B flat, F, B flat. They can't, you know, it's all over the place. It's because, first of all, air is not going through the notes. And the second of all, the buzz of the note could be better, just an individual buzz on the note. But the next thing is getting that buzz to go with your lips to choom. Jake would always talk about it like it's a real fast lip gliss, you know, but like that. And not a jerk, but really a quick movement with your lips. So, and then if you tongue a note, if you do two notes in a row, you know, like F, F, G, F, G, A flat, da, da, that tongue, da, 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 has got to go exactly in the rhythm, but it's got to match the slur. Mm-hmm. So slurring match, you know, I match the tongue to the slur. And in the early years, now John did that too, but in earlier years when Remington was there, some of the people were tonguing a lot of the notes. Mm-hmm. I'm pretty sure about that. It broke off into two schools. Mm-hmm. I think generally that's the case. And all I've just kind of been in that other school, and I've just always just tried to make it smooth, mm-hmm. you know. And so that in teaching, that to me, if you can make a lip slur, if you can go three notes in a row with a great sound and back, with no stuff in the middle of the sound in one position, and then if you can move, and then if you have to move the slide in the slur and get that same kind of connection, and then you do that and have to tongue a note in there, if you can do those three things, you can play anything. Because mm-hmm. the rest of playing, you know, the ta-ta-ta-ta, all the articulated stuff is, you know, you have a chance then, you know. So many times I have people and come in for lessons and stuff like that, and they play boom, ba 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 boom, ba wah 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 wah. You know,
right.
Now it's not written to slur, but it doesn't sound good unless you make it really smooth. You know,
right. Right.
So I spend a lot of time. The easy things that people are so into are the technical part of it. But the making one slur, one note go to another note without any stuff in the middle is what I do in my life, and that's my teaching. Mm. So that's it, right?
That's beautiful.
There.
It's simple and profound.
It's simple.
The same thing.
Yeah.
You know, it's great. It's great, great words.
In the past 3 years, I've been doing Taekwondo with my son who does Taekwondo and Hapkido. He will have a black belt in March and a black belt in Hapkido in June. I'll have my black belt probably within this year sometime. The art of martial arts is exactly the same thing as playing the trombone. Mm-hmm. It drives me nuts because I know what I can see these guys do these flying kicks or see their body move and they have perfect stances. I can see all that. But my body, I'm still a high school trombone player, a high school martial artist, but my mind is right there with them, mm-hmm. you know?
Yeah, yeah.
So my body is not, in the arts, the stances and stuff, it's like a lip slur. Mm-hmm. It's the same attention to basic fundamentals. Mm-hmm. And that's what it's all about. And that's what it's all about, you know, when, in great athletics, in the very beginning, it's about basic fundamentals. And so I'm wanting my basic fundamentals to be better than they are in this martial art because I want it. And mm-hmm. And people who come to me in teaching or in playing, and, you know, they want to play the David, mm-hmm. but they can't play his lip slur yet. Mm-hmm. So it's...
That's
unbelievable. It pisses really, me off. I'm too old for this shit.
Well, it's really well said and incredibly good advice. I've always thought as dabbling Kent and I dabbled in golf over our years with the Stones but it's the same.
It's the same.
Playing golf is the same as a brass instrument. It's controlling your mind and the attention to detail and the fundamentals, just as you put so well. Well, Charlie, you were so generous in offering all that. Just to kind of come back to it a little bit, if you had to just kind of capsulize that one piece of advice that you would give to a young player right now, especially somebody who's looking at possibly an orchestral career, if you could just, in a real kind of nutshell, what would you say to them?
I'd say, I would say the first thing that in an audition or in any kind of a situation, the very first thing that people are going to hear is the tone quality. Mm. If you start off with a half-assed sound, it's going to immediately go south. It's just not going to work. Great sound followed by another great sound. This lip slur thing is the basis of great playing. If you can do that, that means that you can concentrate and focus on what needs to be focused on. And if you can do that, then you can concentrate on the notes and these stupid excerpts one at a time until you figure out exactly what you want in your head. And then it becomes a matter of having the tune really ingrained in your head and playing with as much conviction and musical conviction as you possibly can, and record everything that you do, and listen back, play in front of people. But basically, it's what I do all the time in teaching. It's basically you want to have the best possible physical, mental approach to play on the trombone and make the best possible sound. Mm. Because that's, you know, when we listen, I've listened to I would say over 2,000 auditions in the Chicago Symphony, mm. horn, trumpet, mm-hmm. especially those. And you sit there, you know, on the other side of the screen, guys, you go, oh, fuck, okay. Okay, there we go. Yeah, yeah. On the other side of the screen, where's my iPhone? You're sitting there playing, reading, legs crossed, waiting for somebody to come in there and go, bom, 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 you know, waiting for, oh my God.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And it's, and this many people audition, that many people come in with passion and conviction and musicality, and they grab your attention. And if you grab somebody's attention like that, and then play really well. And then every now and then there's something screw up. The person listening is like, oh, that's okay.
Yeah.
But if you start off right off the bat with half-assed sound, crappy articulation, pitch all over the place, and no rhythm, you're dead.
Yeah.
So those are the things that it boils down to that. Now, to get a job and actually to maintain in playing, we all think about those things, those basic things all the time. You know, it's got to be in the right rhythm. It's got to have the best sound, and it's got to be in tune. My God, you know. Mm-hmm. So I would say that would be about it.
Yeah, I think it'll keep you busy for a while.
Yeah.
But, no, it's,
rest your life.
All kidding aside, that's really really great advice, Charlie. Mm-hmm. And I just want to say thank you one more time for coming down today. I know you finished your rehearsal. You were kind enough to come down, and then you're headed right back up to Carnegie tonight. So thank you for that. And, you know, you said something at the beginning of the interview how you'd like a do-over.
Oh, my God.
But you know what? I have to say that I think you've done so much for the bass trombone, so much for music, so much for orchestras around the world and what you're doing with Chicago. I think there's no reason for you to have a do-over. You've done such an amazing work in your life as a musician and as a bass trombonist and tenor trombone, alto trombone. So thank you for everything you've done. Thanks
My
for
pleasure.
Taking time out
thank
today.
You, thank
and
you.
We will see all of you next time on Bone to Pick.